Hi friends, welcome to the LA Zoo Presents Animal Drawalongs with Brian Kesinger. I'm your host, Sienna Spencer-Markles from the LA Zoo. And for those of you joining us for the first time, I'd like to introduce our talented friend and artist, Brian Kesinger, who has worked with Disney, Marvel, and Lucasfilm, and you may also know him through his own successful Otto and Victoria franchise, as well as many other cool characters and worlds that he's created over the years. This is our fourth and final session of our Draw Along series as we bring the zoo to you. In this series, we're taking a closer look at four endangered species that the LA Zoo is actively helping to save from extinction. Today, we'll be drawing the Western Lowland Gorilla, specifically the LA Zoo's new gorilla baby, Angela, who was born on January 18th, making her almost 4 months old. Angela was the first gorilla birth at the LA Zoo for over 20 years. These gorillas are critically endangered in the wild, so every birth is extremely exciting and significant. First-time mother Ingia, who is 25 years old, came to the LA Zoo in 2018 from the San Diego Zoo as part of a breeding recommendation through the AZA's Species Survival Plan program. Similar to human mothers, female gorillas give birth to one infant after a 9-month pregnancy. Newborns are tiny and helpless at birth, clinging to their mother's fur, nursing, and not able to do much else. Infants ride on their mother's backs from the age of 4 months through about the first 2 or 3 years of their lives. These peaceful animals are social and live in stable, cohesive groups composed of one silverback adult male, several adult females, and their offspring. This species of gorilla is native to the lowlands and swamp forests of Central Africa. Unfortunately, the Western Lowland gorillas are currently considered critically endangered in the wild due to illegal hunting and poaching, habitat degradation and destruction, and susceptibility to diseases such as the Ebola virus. Despite the fact that all killing, capture, and consumption of great apes is illegal, hunting for bushmeat is the primary reason for the Western Lowland gorilla's decline. The exact number of Western Lowland gorillas is not known because they inhabit some of the most dense and remote rainforests in Africa. Because of poaching and disease, the gorillas' numbers have declined by more than 60% over the last 20 to 25 years. Even if all the threats to the Western Lowland gorilla were removed, scientists calculate that the population would require some 75 years to recover. Once we're open to the public again, LA Zoo guests can visit the Campo Gorilla Reserve to see Mama Ingia, Papa Kelly, and their baby Angela, along with their companions Rapunzel and Evelyn. And in the meantime, you can check out our YouTube channel for plenty of videos of baby Angela. Okay, here we go. Get your paper, your pens, and pencils ready. Take it away, Brian.
Hey, thanks so much, Sienna. Thanks, everyone, for coming by and hanging out with us today. I'm very excited to draw this cute little animal and show you guys how to draw her as well. It's been an amazing 4 weeks. Can't believe this is our fourth session. And excited to get into this one. Congratulations to all of you, too, that made it through the trials of drawing the peninsular pronghorn last week. That one was technically challenging, and we wanted to kind of push you guys a little. But I'm happy to say that this little gorilla is going to be a little simpler. So don't just get discouraged. And remember, this is all about learning. So we'll just work through it together. So let's start with our little warm-up exercises, right? I have my warm-up sheet from last time. And this is really going to come in handy with this one because we're going to be drawing a lot of circles and curves and whatnot. So go ahead and, you know, just draw out some circles here and loosen up your hands. It's been a week since we drew together last, so let's go ahead and just loosen up and This is kind of like doing our stretches right before exercise, getting everything kind of warmed up. I'm going with a little more handheld camera today, just so I can show you the drawing a little easier. So I apologize if it's a little shakier than normal, but I think it'll be better for you guys to actually see what I'm doing and to follow along. So just, you know, loosen up and remember we're drawing wide circles using our whole hand. And if you can, lift your elbow off the table, right? I'll show you here. And move your whole arm, right? Because that's really going to help give you the most organic shapes, the organic feeling to your drawing, and nice loose with a lot of energy. So we got that good. So we can move on to our page here. Blank page. And we did double check. We are referencing the same image now, so we'll be good to go. So you should see little Angela there on your screen, and that's the same one I'm going to be drawing from. And shout out to my friend Angela, who I know is watching out there and very excited with the naming of this certain baby gorilla. So, hey, Ange, thanks for watching. We're going to start like we do most times, with just a line at a slight angle, okay? So we're just going to go, and lightly, if you're using a pencil, lightly just sketch in a line there. Just got a little bit of an angle. All right, not too bad. Now go ahead, and we're going to make a T or a cross here, and a little bit more than halfway up. Our T, and that's going to be light as well. Get some shadows here from my phone. Let's see if we can lighten that up. Like so. Great. A nice little T there on our page. And that's really going to be those anchor points for us, right? That we talk about when we're drawing these animals. Finding ways to give ourselves little locations to draw from so that we know we can kind of see how the animals put together a little bit. So the first thing we're going to do is go here and on this top line here at the end of both points, right? So you have a line that ends here, ideally equidistant from your center line. Go ahead and do a slight curved, very slightly curved line to connect those two dots. See that there? Great. Now we're going to take those same two dots and do a much broader curve, almost like a half circle, connecting the bottom line. And that can go, you can have it go down to about halfway between your eye line and the end of your T there. About halfway there. Connect that line there. And what that's going to give us is that pretty iconic eye mask that you see on little Angela there, where the fur is coming away and you see more of the skin. And get that there, which is good. Now, the distance between where your half circle ended and here, your original T section there, go ahead and split that line in half. So, and draw a line out that way. And that's actually going to be where we're going to place the eyes. But before we do that, I'm going to work on that signature muzzle of the gorilla, right? That's even prominent even when they're a baby, right? It gets much more pronounced as they grow up. But what we're going to do is from this new half line that you created here to the bottom of your T. I want you to kind of draw and watch what I do before you draw it. But I'm going to draw kind of a wide teardrop shape without a point at the top. It's also maybe looks like a little bit of a water balloon, right? Without the tie. I get that shape in there. You can see already we're getting some fun gorilla shapes on our page, right? If you look at your shapes compared to the photo, you can kind of see that this water balloon shape is going to be the muzzle and that great big nose. And this part here is going to be the mask for the eye, right? And now what I'd love for you to do is from the bottom of your water balloon there, we're going to go and make almost a balloon shape going the other direction. Lots of balloons today. I'm going to connect there and connect there like that. Okay. So this gives us the overall shape of the head and the structure. Now there's something I want to talk to you guys about this week, specifically when drawing baby animals or baby anything for that matter, and talking about what makes a cute drawing and how can you make something really look like it's a younger animal. And there's two things that you can that help in that endeavor. The first is proportion, right? And the second is detail. The first being proportion that I'm going to talk about now. If you look at the picture, look how big little Angela's cranium is, like the top of her head compared to her face, right? That's a real big sign that this is a baby animal, right? When you get those kind of proportions and an enlarged head with smaller features is one real visual cue. So we're going to do that. If you look at our drawing now, it's pretty even. So what I'm going to do is have you extend that line from the bottom of your face mask, right? That little line there. And then where it intersects with the balloon of the head shape of the skull, go ahead and make an even bigger kind of circle. Like so. So now it looks like she's almost wearing a helmet, right? Cool. Awesome job. I'll talk about details and how details can help us describe if this is a younger animal or not in a little bit. But the next big step we're going to do is the eyes, right? So if you go back to your little blueprint here, this line, which was our initial T line, and the halfway point here, go ahead and cut that in half like this. Two times. We're going to work on the placement of the eyes. Okay. Now, we want to add a circle. Roughing that circle so that the bottom of the circle is touching where the initial water balloon ended. And it's riding halfway on either side of the circles there. See that? Great. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Now, what we want to do, go back to your center line right here, the distance between the top of the water balloon and the bottom of the eye mask line, right? Right there. I want you to draw two kind of curves coming off of there, almost like you're making a Y shape. Cool. Awesome. Now follow that water balloon shape down and curve it back in to where it's almost touching the center line. Working on those great big nostrils, right? Helps the animal to smell even more, get more air in. All sorts of great evolutionary advantages to that signature nose. We're going to do that on the other side. Follow the water balloon down and curve it back in to there. And if you need to, you can always draw another line at the bottom just to make sure that the curves are ending at the same spot. Right? Great. Now, back at your Y that you initially created right here, go ahead and halfway through, give it a little bridge so that you get a shape like this at the top of the nose there. Now, following this line, the center line back down, we're going to pull a couple lines this way. Just a mirror image on the other side there. You know, unfortunately, we can't go and see these animals in person right now. But this photograph by Jamie Pham is the next best thing. Their photography is just amazing. And it's been super helpful with all these draw alongs. So shout out to them for their amazing work. And
shout out to Jamie Pham. You just was featured on Nikon, their social media, as one of their Nikon ambassadors.
Amazing.
Amazing. That's cool. Photography.
Yeah, so good.
You watch Jamie.
Yay. Cool. So we got the nose in place. That's great. And now we're going to give this photo is so great because it almost looks like she's got a little smile, right? She looks a little mischievous in this picture. So what I want you to do about halfway down and watch me before you do it. So it's clear. We're going to kind of just give a little off-center kind of smirk. I might be caricaturing this a little bit, but that's okay. Because there's such amazing life in this photo, in this animal, that you want to try to bring some of that into your drawing, even though it's a little simpler and maybe not as photo real as the photograph. We're trying to capture the spirit of it. And you can go ahead and give her as big of a smile as you want. It's your drawing. But I think she's pretty sweet. So I'm giving her a little, little sweet smile here. Great. Awesome. Now let's go back to the face mask. Those two initial points on either side, right? We're going to start on the left-hand side and have a curve come up even bigger, but then curve back in at the center point. Working on that great big bridge of the eyebrow. Which again, you know, gorillas are really known for having an amazing profile and these details get much more pronounced as they grow up. But it's very interesting to observe how they present themselves even at the young age, right? And now we're going to do the same thing on the other side. Remember, we talked that big word last week, bilateral symmetry, two words technically. We're really seeing that symmetry here on this animal. Just do a mirror image on the other side there, like so. Amazing. This is also the first animal we've drawn. You heard me talk a lot on the other lessons about placement of eyes on the animal, right? So this is the first one that we're drawing where the eyes are on the front of their faces as opposed to the side. So, which also gives them more of their human look, right? A lot of similarities between this animal and humans from a physical standpoint. So kind of interesting. Now I'm gonna keep her with these kind of wide eyes because I think it aids in her expression. But what we're going to do is give her a little bit of a lower lid. So at the bottom fourth of the circle, just draw a line in there on both of those eyes. And then where that line intersects the circle, go ahead and give a shallow curve. And that's going to kind of indicate a lower eyelid. You see the difference there between that eye and that eye? Starting to get a little more life into it. Awesome. Do the same on the other side. For those of you that might be following along digitally on an iPad or a tablet, some drawing programs have symmetry tools, which I use quite a bit, which allow you to only draw one half and then it copies it onto the other side, which is a real handy thing, especially when designing creatures, because you can kind of just sketch out one half and it starts to build the other half for you. But we're working without a net here. Yeah.
Speaking of designing creatures, does drawing baby Angela remind you of any creatures or characters that you've done in the past?
Oh, definitely. Especially one that's very special to me because it was the first movie I worked on, and that's Tarzan. I had to learn a lot about gorillas and how to draw them for that movie. I was 18 years old. Fresh out of high school and working on that amazing movie. So there was lots of reference photos, much like this. A small contingent of the art team actually went to the Congo and got to trek alongside some gorillas, which is pretty amazing. So they brought back a lot of footage that they took. So even though I was working in the layout department on that movie, drawing the jungles in the backgrounds, I still had to know how to draw the animals because we would actually indicate to the animators where the characters would go. So we'd have to draw them in roughly for placement. So drawing Angela here definitely takes me back to that amazing movie.
Wow. No wonder you're so good at it.
A little bit of practice. So we have both our bottom eyelids there. Go ahead and thicken up the top line of the circle for those eyes, because that's going to be her upper eyelid. And by making it thicker, we give the impression that the skin of the eyelid is pressed up against the skin closer to the skull, right? And now you can see in that photo, there's a lot of wrinkles, right? And this is an interesting decision for us as an artist to make right now, because normally we associate wrinkles and lines on the face like that with older characters, right? Older people, older animals. But here we really want to get across in our drawing that this is a baby gorilla. So we're going to selectively choose which ones we put in there. Again, this is true if you were drawing a human child, like with baby Tarzan, right? In the Tarzan movie, we not only had to draw him as a human, as an adult, but as a baby when he's first discovered by the gorilla in the abandoned treehouse. So we use a lot less lines. But what I want for you guys to do, because there are, if we had none of those wrinkles in there, it wouldn't really look like Angela. So we're going to pick some of the big ones that stand out to us. And what we're going to do is from about where you drew the top of your eyelid, a little further out. Let me get in there closer so you can see. A little further out, just drag a line down to the face mask there. And do that on the other side as well. Great. And then from the circle here, right, the bottom of the circle, drag another line out connecting to the face mask there. There's a subtle trick that I'm doing here. Some of you probably can see, but some of you might not realize it's going on, is I'm making sure that whatever lines I'm adding all help in the expression I'm trying to get across, right? Which is all kind of geared towards that little smile that I see in Jamie's original photo. So smiles tend to be associated with lines moving up. So you can see I have the eyebrows going up and I have these wrinkles going up, almost like they're followed, like they're little smiles in and of themselves, which again helps. And go ahead and add that second smile line over there on that side.
Hey, Brian, I wanted to ask you, now that we've watched you draw four different animals, is there a method to the order that you choose to draw each feature? Like for us non-artists, I feel like, you know, we always want to draw the eyes first. You know, like the eyes, nose, mouth, but you save the eyes for last. I was wondering if you can talk a little bit about the artistic method behind what you're, the order that you're drawing.
Very great question. We're taught often as artists to work from big to small, right? It's very much, you know, building your foundation before you build a house, right? Like you wouldn't design a house with the windows first, right? You kind of design the structure of everything around it so that all the details can fit in nicely. So now that's just a rule for learning. And as with all art, there really is no rules. But if you want to build a solid drawing and you're learning, it's good. It's easier to tackle and you have a better sense of your drawing as a whole if you work from big to small.
Oh, that makes sense.
Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there's, of course, artists. There's one artist I really love, and I think I brought him up before, Brian Froud. And he was a concept designer for Jim Henson. He worked on The Dark Crystal and Labyrinth. And if you look at his drawings, he does amazing sketches and drawings. And he always starts with the eyes. And he will literally start by drawing, I'll do a little detour here. they'll start by drawing a little angry brow in a circle, right? And then he'll put a little pupil in there, and then he'll draw the rings coming out and the wrinkly head up like so. And this might resemble, this dark crystal character might resemble a certain condor that we drew in our first stream. But he's got that big sneer. And you can see everything's kind of radiates out from that eye, right? But that's an artist who's had, you know, decades of experience and can kind of see things in his head a little quicker, right? So you can eventually get to that point, and sometimes I do that too, even with my human characters. But for learning purposes, it's very much like building a house. We got to get our blueprint. We got to know where everything goes. And then we can decide what curtains to put in the window.
Great.
So we're going to add a couple more curves, and then we'll move on to the fur, and then we'll be done. So you guys are doing great. And then I'll make you draw the pronghorn again after as a special surprise. But
bonus challenge.
So, bonus challenge, lightning round. So this top curve of the eye, a little bit higher. We're just going to draw another one that kind of just mirrors it. The top eyelid. Look how much more character is in the drawing now, too, by adding these lines. That's what's interesting. They say that the most important feature on a human's face when you're drawing it, on any character's face, is the eyebrows. That's the most expressive part. By adding all these supplemental lines to help aid the expression, I'm going to add one more here. One more here. Like so. And that's going to do it for the wrinkles, the amount of wrinkles I want to put on this drawing of baby Angela. Again, I want to keep a big word we use in animation is appeal. And it's an important word because it's kind of a unknown quantity, but it's something that it results in people looking at something and going, oh, right. Or having an attraction to it. So rather than labor this with so many wrinkles and details, we're going to selectively pick which ones we want in there, right? But now let's move on to the fur. Oh, there are actually two more lines I do want, because if you look at a photo above her eyebrows, she's got those great wrinkles in her forehead. And again, I don't want to put all of those in, because if you draw on them, she might look older than she is. But we are going to add just like two slightly curved lines centered above the two eyebrows, just to indicate that detail, right? Because we don't want to shortchange the features of the animal, but we also want to be a little selective. And again, this is more advanced skills, but we're 4 weeks into this, so I know you guys can handle it.
Robin from the zoo just did a great pun to have ape peel. She wants the animal to have
ape
peel.
Thank you. Robin. Oh, amazing. Yes, more of that, please.
We welcome all gorilla and great ape puns at this time.
Yeah, they really are handy. Because like a banana, you do want it to be appealing. So let's work on the fur here. Now the fur, we're going to give ourselves some guidelines, right? So watch what I do here. I'm going to go from the mask to the side of the jaw there and draw these lines kind of radiating out, almost like stripes, right? So 1, 2, 3, 4. Give yourself 4 kind of curved stripes that connect this line to that line. And that's a good point you bring up, Sienna, right? These are apes and not monkeys. An important distinction.
Yes.
But and you guessed it, we're going to add four more of those guidelines on the other side, connecting the two. Draw these in kind of lightly. Cool. Now, we're going to do, who here has seen Spaceballs? It looks like she's wearing a Spaceballs helmet right now. We're going to draw from your center line here. Go ahead and have the center line go all the way up now to the extended circle we drew up there. And then from that point right here, go ahead and have lines, curved lines, kind of radiating out that way. And then looks like the other side. Almost looks like a peacock crest tail up here with those lines on there. Now, what that does is that's now given us a roadmap to indicate the direction of our fur growing out of her head, right? In simpler drawings, we would have just maybe done a jaggy line at the top and the sides, but you guys are better than that. And what this does is allows you to fill in these areas with more lines and just make them parallel to the lines that you drew. So you're almost like filling in the in-between of the two lines, right? And do this lightly as well. But go ahead and fill in those lines, but following the arcs of the curves that you put in there.
Ooh, this is the fun part.
Yeah, here we go.
And for those of you who wish to color your gorilla, after you're done drawing it, if you would like to color it in or paint it, these gorillas have short black brown hair. They have a prominent ridge along their brow, and the infants have a tuft of white hair on their backsides, and then older gorillas may have silver streaks in their hair, like Angela's dad, Kelly, does. The silverback.
Yes. Or in Tarzan, it was Kerchak, was the male gorilla that had that great silverback. So cool. We got our fur in there. Now what you can do, now that you have all those lines in there, you can go through and kind of connect. Get in a little closer so you can see. Connect these lines with a little jaggy kind of sawtooth. But by adding those guidelines in first, you've given a nice organic feel to the fur that feels like it's wrapping around the animal's skull. And I haven't forgotten about the eyes, but we're going to put those pupils in last. And you'll see really little Angela come to life on your page. So go ahead and finish that sawtooth kind of texture. She's a baby, and it's fun. If you check out the LA Zoo Instagram, I'm sure on Facebook as well, they share the same photos and videos. There's I always love seeing the videos of her, you know, hanging on to her mom. There's a great one they posted today where she's eating her lettuce. I think it was lettuce that she was eating. just so much character, so much charm, so much appeal.
I believe she just started eating recently. She was nursing for the last several months. It was very sweet.
And it's Mother's Day tomorrow. So I want to say happy Mother's Day to everyone who's out there watching. Sienna, you as well. And to my wife, Jenny. Very special day. I know it's a different way to celebrate given all that's going on, but to all the human moms and animal moms out in the world right now, happy early Mother's Day. Great. So we have all our fur in there now. And look at the photo again. Look how she's got the little bit of stubble coming off her upper lip and the lower part of her chin, even though it's that leathery skin there. It's a really charming little detail, and it's easy to add. Just add little dashes, these little lines kind of coming off there, almost like peach fuzz. And then the same on the upper lip as well. Indicate some of that there. And now for the eyes. Look at the photo for a little bit and just look at how amazing those gorilla eyes are, right? It's not like a human eye in that we have a lot of white and then we have the color of our iris and then the pupil. It's almost all iris with that really great deep brown. So one thing I'd like you guys to do, if you can, if you're using a pencil, is shade the whole eye in. I'm gonna try to do it first. I'm gonna leave a couple circles. You can see those white highlights that are in there, a couple circles in there. And I'm gonna lightly shade in the whole eye with the exception of those circles, just lightly shading. With darker shading in the center of that eye, go ahead and do a smaller circle. And shade that in even darker. And you'll get that very warm and soulful eye of the gorilla, of little Angela. Mysteriously, a baby gorilla has materialized on your page. Through the magic of the internet and the LA Zoo, a little bit of me, you got an ape to appear on your page. There are a couple lines I forgot, just the bridge of the nose. So just in the center, go ahead and do three little curved lines. Star Wars fans will notice Yoda has those same three lines on the bridge of his nose as well. Again, all creature design, good creature design is based on the animals around us, because there's a good chance that when nature is concerned, truth is stranger than fiction. So there's a lot we can learn from these amazing animals. I'm going to start inking this, but the drawing is done. So congratulations. If you guys have any questions, I think we have about 15 minutes left. Let me know. Also, if you can, take a screenshot of this and your drawing, and we'd love to see it. So Sienna, do you want to tell them a little bit of how they can share it?
Yeah, absolutely. As Brian continues to draw and ink, I'd love to hear from where you're watching from, if you'd like to put those in the comments. And please do share your art today. You can post it on any social media platform and just tag LA Zoo, at LA Zoo and at Brian Kesinger, so we can see them. And we have Altadena is watching. Burbank. First.
Yay, Burbank.
Madison, Wisconsin.
Oh, wow. Amazing.
Sherman Oaks.
Shout out to my friend Karen, too, who is in Massachusetts and woke up to snow this morning. So we're a little spoiled here in
aren't
LA.
We like
Yeah. But I know there's a lot of people today waking up to kind of a cold morning. So,
our animals would be shocked.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
We have Fairfax, Virginia, Oakland, Brentwood, Los Angeles.
Yay.
Scotland.
What?
Aberdeen, Scotland. How fun. Helsinki, amazing. Finland. We wow. had some Finnish people last week.
That's right.
UK, Van Nuys, Los Feliz, Torrance. We got a lot of SoCal shout outs.
Yeah, incredible.
Does anyone have any questions for Brian in terms of drawing art, drawing animals, observing animals, what his favorite animals are to draw, any characters that he has worked on, movies that he's worked on, any questions about Otto the octopus that he has created, his character, signature character he's created?
We also have a coloring book, right, that people can download from the LA Zoo website that I did. Again, that's working right. with Jamie's photographs. So if you are a little intimidated about the drawing but still want to be creative, you can definitely go to the website, and it's a free coloring book for you print it out.
We had so many spring babies born at the zoo. Brian created a spring babies coloring book, and Angela is in there along with several other fun species babies.
Yes.
We have Munster, Germany.
Wow.
Santa Monica, Dallas, Texas, North Hollywood. We have a couple questions here.
Yeah.
What are some of your favorite animals to draw?
Favorite animals to draw? Definitely rhino. I love drawing rhinos. I love drawing big like emus and ostrich, because I love their legs, right? And they're kind of like little dinosaurs, closest thing we have to dinosaurs. If you really look, really take a look next time you're next to an ostrich, take a look at their feet, and it's incredible. I mean, it looks like raptor feet, right? So they're very fun to draw. I also like to draw, that's why I really enjoyed the condor the first week, because I enjoy drawing their kind of curved necks. And what else do I definitely the octopus. The octopus is probably my favorite to draw for many reasons. But one of the main reasons being they're very forgiving. They're very easy to draw because they have no skeleton. So a lot of times with animals with bones and skeletons, it's a little harder because there's some structure in there, right? But with an octopus, they're all muscle, and they're amazing creatures. So you could do a whole live stream just on the wonders of the octopus, but that's
and you
definitely
have.
My favorite. And I have many, actually. So you'll see. Go ahead.
Sorry.
I was just going to say, as I ink this fur, I'm not inking every line I drew, and I'm also not inking the entire line, but rather going through almost like dashed lines. And again, this gives the appearance of something softer, something furrier than the eye mask, where we see the skin and the smoothness of that texture. So just a little tip, if you are taking this to inking, that you might consider breaking up the line a little bit.
And Brian, people are asking, what do you like to color with or paint with? How would you finish this drawing?
Oh,
what are your favorite brands?
You know what? I'll show you because this will be easy, and it'll be kind of a fun bonus. Let me just quickly ink the bottom here, and I'll show you. That's a great question, because normally I do color these and finish off these drawings. And normally I would finish inking it before going in and coloring it. But for demonstration purposes, do not try this at home. I am going to take these markers that I really like and that are called Copic markers. Where's the logo? Hashtag not an ad. These Copic markers are really great. And as you can see, they come in a ton of colors.
Right? Wow.
All sorts of shades. Because since they are markers, they don't blend, right? So you kind of have to get a lot of different shades so you can build up the different values. But what's cool is, I'll show you, I'm going to color in, and there are these nice brush tips, right? So what you can do is, I like to really use the brush tip, kind of scoop the ink up, like so. And what that does is, much like watercolor, when you're using markers, you want it, it's almost what you don't color in that's just as important as what you do. So that skin on little Angela's face right there is so shiny, right? It's got all those great little highlights. It is, it's like black leather, right? And so I'm not going to go in and color this all in like I would a traditional coloring book, right? Where you want to color into all the lines. You want to leave some of those white spaces. Now, if I was using paint like acrylic or oils or gouache, I could paint those highlights in. But with watercolor and these kind of alcohol-based markers, you have to kind of plan ahead. And for me, that's part of the fun and part of the challenge of working with it, right? And so we're going to go ahead. And notice that even my brush strokes are going along those guidelines and along the form, so that it has dimension to it, right? And I'm even going to, it's got that great lower lip highlight. I really want to accentuate that. I really want to give a cute upper lip. Because that's what is nice about these is, notice I can go over an area with the same marker and it's a little darker. So it's almost like shading a little bit.
Everyone is just melting right now.
It really does bring it to life, right? I mean, these drawings that we've been doing are pretty analytical in that they're how to draw drawings, right? So there's not a lot of warmth or character, but why I'm happy to show you this step on this last video is so that you can see where all this hard work can get you. Right? By studying and observing and using great resources like the LA Zoo, you can really become a better artist and learn all the tricks, right? And also, you'll see that because we don't have all those wrinkles in there, she still is pretty cute, right? And I'm going to do the eyes so you can see the eyes, because it's really going to come together. See those
eyes. Yes, Rachel just said you just took it to a whole new level.
Thank you, Rachel. So I'm using like a light brown in here. It's mixing with the blue a little bit of the pencil, which is okay. Normally I would erase all the blue line before coloring, but sometimes keeping the blue line helps keep the warmth of the drawing. There we go. Now with a little darker brown going in. And again, leaving those really bright white highlights keep the life in Angela's eyes. And what I'm going to do too is so that those eyes really pop, I'm going to take a lighter gray. Which one? That's a problem. All the colors I need, but which one to use? I'm going to use this one. Oh, no, that one's out of ink. These markers are nice, though, because they are refillable, which is really handy. Not a lot of markers aren't, but these are. So now I'm going to go through. And even the areas I left white, I'm going to shade in with this very light gray. So that, the reason being, that the lightest part that we see is the lights in Angela's eyes, right? And of course, it's looking very incomplete without that great blue-brown fur around, so I have to add that now. That's the problem. It's like a snowball. It's like once you get started, it's like, oh, well, don't forget this. So let's go ahead. And that won't take long, though.
When do you know when you're done?
You never will. And that's a skill into itself of knowing when to stop. And fortunately in animation, there's plenty of people that give you deadlines and you have to stick to those deadlines. So a lot of times the deadlines tell you when it's time to stop. But over time, like I know not to overwork this face anymore, just because I'm in front of a live audience and it could go south really quick. But also, like, you know, it's a sketch, right? It's just something for learning sake. Now watch, this is going to be really cool though, because I'm going to add this black fur in and I'm going to do it kind of graphically, meaning just like in big shapes, kind of stylistically, but it's going to tie the whole thing together and her face is just going to pop. This is going to be pretty cool.
Didn't you say last week that drawing the skeletal or the first layer is like eating your vegetables and then coloring or adding the features is when you get to have dessert or something like that?
Oh, that's exactly right. And we're definitely having dessert right now. Because notice how much faster this step is too, right? Like we've spent only about 5 minutes coloring, and it's added so much to the drawing, but only because we ate all our vegetables and spent so much time.
Wow. Look at that. Someone just commented, their 7-year-old said, I love how it just became 3D.
Oh, that's so nice. That's a very nice observation, because part of the reason why it became 3D is, again, because I'm using those brush strokes, right? And notice even how I'm coloring in her fur, I'm following those guidelines. So it looks like it's wrapping around. And I'm even using a different style of brush stroke, right? Everything, again, this is another kind of advanced lesson, but you guys have just had 4 weeks of drawing class, so you're ready for it. Everything, every detail in your drawing should help tell the story you want to tell, right? So here we have a very amazing animal, right? But she's a baby, so she's young, she's wild, and we're going to let even these brush strokes indicate that she's a wild animal that's young, has a whole life ahead of her, and a lot of adventures too, right? So rather than doing a simpler or a more planned out brushstroke, right, that I might do to show a more elegant character, with this, it's like the ultimate bedhead, right? She's climbing around mom. She's just having a good time. So why not have a good time with our lines, right? Now, again, I left that big white spot in there. That's just to show the highlight of the fur, but it's far too bright right now, right? So what we're going to do is go back to our initial skin color, and I'm going to color in this area where those wrinkles are. Sorry, it's off. So, and then I'm going to color in this area. So again, it's not, nothing is fighting the main focus of the drawing, which are her eyes.
Just right, like the picture.
Exactly. Thank you, Jamie. Right? Like it's prioritizing all those details. Look at that fuzzy face. And to do this, to reinforce it even more, right, I'm going there. I'm going to go through and use the brush size and darken. Oops, sorry. Get it on camera. Darken around the eyes so that the ultimate point of contrast is between the eyes. And all these fur lines, look where they're all pointing to, right? They're all pointing to the eye. All those wrinkles, they're all radiating off of the eye. Even the cute little smile is pulling the viewer's eye back to the eye. So that's very roughly how I would finish this drawing off.
Wow. I'm blown away.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It was fun to do that. I really enjoy the coloring phase. I was glad someone asked.
Yes, and so we've done four very different animals over the past 4 weeks. We did a vulture, a frog, an antelope, and a gorilla. We've had a taste of how different and difficult each one is to draw, uh-huh. But I feel like the gorilla is the most familiar because it's the most human, you know, the most like us.
Yes, yes, right.
And if anyone has done all four or any of the weeks, please feel free to post them, tag them. Yeah. You could even do a collage or a composite of all four, which would be fun.
Oh, that would be cool. Yeah. Trying to see. I'm pulling out the other ones so we can see them all side by side. There's Mr. Pronghorn. And then our yellow... legged, what was it? Yellow mountain legged.
Southern mountain. I know it's a long one. Southern, yeah. Mountain yellow legged frog.
That's right. That's right. What she said. And then our condor as well, California condor. So it's been an amazing 4 weeks. Thank you, Sienna. Thank you, LA Zoo, and thank you all of you for hanging out and being a part of this.
Thank you so much for drawing with us, Brian. It's been a pleasure for everyone. And who knows, we may do it again in the future, so stay tuned.
Yeah, I'm gonna miss these. So, and maybe when this is all over and we can all visit the zoo and draw together in person, that would be awesome too.
Absolutely. The zoo is a wonderful place to sketch animals from real life. So this is it. Thank you so much for joining us. This is our final draw along. And again, please post your drawings and tag LA Zoo and Brian Kesinger on any social media platform. And I just want to take a moment to invite everyone to please join our very special virtual fundraising event, the Beastly Ball, which is happening next Friday, May 15th at 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. This is a very special once-a-year event. We're going virtual this year. It'll be a really fun-filled night hosted by Joel McHale and featuring the Crap Brothers, Dave Matthews, Lance Bass, LA Mayor Eric Garcetti, and many more guest appearances, plus animal ambassadors, conservation stories, and one auction items. So please join us. You can visit beastlyball.lazoo.org to RSVP now and watch on the 15th. And on behalf of Baby Angela and Brian Kesinger and all of us at the LA Zoo, thank you so much for joining us. Goodbye.
Bye.